Well, good morning, beautiful people. How are you this morning? We're going to go ahead and stand up and open up our service with Heaven Is Here right now. Come on home to Unity.
Probably not.
Oh my goodness, are you serious? Okay, no baby. Just sing, make up your own words. Coming home to Unity, heaven is here right now. Coming home to Unity, heaven is here right now. To laugh and learn and pray, to feel the light within us grow. And now it's time to start, to open every heart to what we already know. We gather here today to laugh and learn and pray, to feel the light within us grow. And now it's time to start, to open every heart to what we already know.
How are you, my dear? Oh, I'm doing well.
Stay well. Good morning.
There's only one presence and one power,
in my life and the universe, God the good.
And we also keep in mind our Christ light. You can hardly see it here today, but it's flickering strongly inside the candle. We have a Christ light within each of us. Christos, the light of God coming through us, and we recognize that every single day. And therefore, it gives us a vision and a mission statement, and let us read this together.
Centered in God, we inspire spiritual transformation, creating a world of love, peace, and prosperity. We are an inclusive spiritual community, inspiring, awakening, and serving in love.
And we bless the children in the world who are here with us today, or not, or within our hearts. Our little children inside of us that we still remember, and we hear those words inside of us when your mommy said, sit quiet in church. Or enjoy your life. You can be anything that you choose to be. Your thoughts determine your own life. So let us bless the children everywhere in this world. We love you.
We bless you. We behold the Christ in you. We accept you just the way you are. Walk in beauty. You are divine.
Okay, we're going to, since the AV's having a little issues this morning, this is name it and claim it. So it's really repetitive. Well, I name it and I claim it and I see it everywhere. Well, I name it and I claim it and I see it everywhere. How hard is that? Okay. Because it's mine, mine all mine, everlasting love of the divine. So I name it and I claim it and I see it everywhere. So that's the gist of the song. So go ahead and stand up. And it's real repetitive, so I will sing you through it. Sorry about the AV. We'll get her straight. This happens when you get new space going and things get twerky, so it's okay. Well, I name it, and I claim it, then I see it everywhere. Well, I name it, and I claim it, and I see it everywhere again. Well, I name it, and I claim it, and I see it everywhere. Well, I name it, and I claim it, and I see it everywhere.
Cause it's mine.
Cause it's mine. Mine, all mine. The endless, everlasting love of the divine. So I name it, and I claim it, and I see it everywhere. Yes, I name it, and I claim it, and I see it everywhere.
Cause it's mine.
Cause it's mine. Mine, oh mine. The endless, everlasting love of the divine. So I name it, and I claim it, and I see it everywhere. Yes, I name it, and I claim it, and I see it everywhere.
Oh yes, I see it everywhere. Oh
yes, I see it everywhere. Yes, I see it. Yes, I see it everywhere.
Hey, y'all did good. Give yourselves a round of applause. And you may have a seat.
And as is our custom, could we have the prayer box come forward, please?
You want one?
Thank you.
Yes, our prayer box that has been moving at the front because of all of our furniture rearranging. And stays at the front during our service, but lives at the back, so there is easy, open access for anybody who chooses to write something down, something that is on their heart, concerning for themselves, for others, in order to place it in here. And in this moment, you know, and the reason why we bring it to the front is to know there is divine energy in this place. This divine energy is multiplied because we are here. And where we focus our attention, that divine energy is focused. So in this moment, we open ourselves to that divine healing power. We ask, we receive, and we accept this healing, what needs to be healed, whatever the situations are, that are written down here. And we turn to those prayers that are in our hearts that will never be written down. And we say, Spirit, we are open and willing to be healed. To be healed that whatever that
basic fundamental level is. We open our hearts now, in this time, in this place. We receive and we accept, and so it is. Amen.
Amen.
At this time, we share a short essay, a prayer, affirmation, based on a piece of sacred scripture. And I asked myself to read the daily word this morning because this was my mantra during chemotherapy and living through that leukemia, and brought me here to this place where I can thrive and stand in front of you now. Psalm 23, verse 4. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for thou art with me, for you are there with me. I said this every single day, many, many times. I fear no evil, for God is with me. And I am relaxed, I am peaceful, and renewed in the love of God. These words from I Am There by English poet James Dillett Freeman reassure me. Do you need me? I am there. Keeping these words close to heart fills me with peace, no matter what is going on in my life. When I feel stress, I take a few moments to rest in the silence of prayer. I begin by letting go of thought and focusing on the comforting idea. Do you need me? I am there. I relax the muscles in my face and neck. I let my shoulders drop. My arms lay loosely in my lap, letting my chair support me. I relax and simply be. I breathe in love, divine and unconditional. I exhale peace, calming and harmonious. Bringing my thoughts back from this brief meditation, I feel relaxed and refreshed, ready to return to my day with a positive, peaceful attitude. So it is. Let us move. As we breathe in that inspiration, let us move forward into our Lord's Prayer. Our
Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debtors, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
And moving even deeper, deeper into that place. Place of oneness, the awareness of oneness. In this moment, let us know we are one with that divine energy, the one presence, the one power. We are always one. In this moment, let us become aware, aware, moving in deeper to that connected place, letting go of our personality in the moment, letting go of whatever our concerns are, knowing we have chosen to be in a place of connection. Allow the words, I am. Was that voice from the burning bush that said, I am that I am. And here now, in this moment, I am that I am. Allow those words. Begin to have an experience of that unconditional love and support this divine energy that loves us where we are. Let go of judging myself. Let go. Divine love loves me here, now. I don't have to do anything. I don't have to be anything. Let me open my own heart to that divine love. Whatever thoughts come to me, let me embrace them with love and let them go. Inspire, breathing in. Breathing out, letting go. Getting quieter and deeper as we move in to the silence of our soul, the silence of that divine within each one of us, the silence that is the truth of this universe and beyond, in the silence. Place of oneness and connectedness, allow unconditional love. You, I, we, me, we are loved unconditionally. What does that mean for you? What does that mean for me? All of that which we may not accept within ourselves, all of that which we want to change, to grow, to develop, and that's wonderful, but we are loved right where we are in this moment. What does that feel like? Letting go of any concerns about not being good enough, not doing it right. We are loved. We are loved before we ever came into this time, into this place. Words that came to Isaiah, before you were in your mother's womb, I knew you. I knew you. That divine energy knows us in ways that we will probably never know ourselves, and we are loved.
And we bask into that, that awareness, and allow that love, and allow our response to that love to be the truth of who we are in this moment. And we reach out and we embrace all of those that we love, bringing them into this connected awareness that we are loved, and that we love, and that we love. And we reach out. We know that this divine energy is not just within ourselves. It radiates out through us. We are all connected. Everybody in this room, we are connected at that basic level of divine love. Everybody in this town, in this state, in this country, in this globe, we are connected. We are connected with the universe beyond our imagining. We allow that love, that river of love, moving in and through us. And for this opportunity to experience, to be aware, we say, thank you, God. And so it is. Amen.
Amen.
What does it mean to have a love affair with God? Have you ever thought about it that way? What is it? You know, do you ever ask yourself, I know I have, and what does that feel like, and what does that mean? So St. Augustine, so this is back in the 3rd or 4th century, when Christianity was kind of becoming formalized, says, to fall in love with God is the greatest of romances. To seek Him, the greatest adventure. To find Him, the greatest human achievement. Think about that. The greatest of romances, because what we know about that love, that divine love, it is totally unconditional. There's nothing we have to do or to be to have that divine love. Now, to experience it, we have to be open, we have to allow, we have to be let that love flow in and through us. But we don't have to do anything. It is given to us. It was given to us in the whole business of creation. This world, this universe is created in a manner that sustains us in so many ways. In the New Testament, 1 John, and we don't know a lot where a lot of these letters were written that are in the New Testament. We don't know if 1 John was actually written by the same person who wrote the book of John or somebody else. However, think about these words and what this person knew. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God. Think about it. If I'm in a place of love, I don't even have to allow or think about that word God at all. If I'm in love, if I'm in that place, I am in God. Whoever lives in love lives in God, and God in them. This is how love is made complete among us, so that we will have confidence on the day of judgment. When is the day of judgment, everybody? Today, here, now, every moment is a day of judgment. And when we know we're coming from that place of love, whatever's going on, we can have confidence. Even if we got it wrong, folks, if we're coming from a place of love, we can have confidence in that judgment. In this world, we are like Jesus. In this world. In this world, we are like Jesus. There is no fear in love. Ooh, now think about that. What kind of teachings do we often hear related to religion? You know, that if you don't do it this way, if you don't do it that way, you are going to perdition, whatever you want. You know, fear is stirred up. And here it is in the New Testament, says, there is no fear in love. The perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. So what is this saying about divine love? Divine love is not going to punish us. That doesn't mean punishment doesn't come, but it comes because of our lack of awareness that we are loved, and we come from a place of fear, and we do things out of fear. But when we know that divine love, we are coming from a place that's very different. And that divine love has no punishment for us. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. So part of this, what am I afraid of? And we can only ask ourselves those questions. And it goes on, we love because he, or this divine spirit, first loved us. Loved us in the whole process of creation. However you vision this creative process, this creation supports us. It supports us in everything we could be, would be, should be. Every dream that we have, this creation supports us in that. Whoever claims to love God, yet hates a brother or a sister, is a liar. Ooh, think about that. Think about some of the conversations that are going on these days. For whoever does not love their brother and their sister, whom they have seen, cannot love God, whom they have not seen. Think about that. That's a very practical process. If I cannot love that which I am connected to and cannot see. But so when we talk about love, what does this mean? So what does it mean, really mean, to have a love affair? You know, and I do come up with titles sometimes, and I go, how am I going to get there? What am I going to do? Where am I going to find, you know, the verses? Well, guess what? Look at those two that were handed to me. But you know, really, and one of the gifts of being able to be a teacher or to be able to be a peer is to find something that also has very deep meaning to me personally, or to whoever the person is up here. So what does that mean to me? What does that mean to me? And as I explored this process, so I invite you into that. What does that mean to you? What does it mean to love God, to have this love affair with God? So one of the first things is, it is reciprocal. And this idea that we can look around us and say, okay, the first love is out here. I am responding to love that is already being shown to me. So what are, you know, and this love is not romantic love. It is not, it's not even parental love, though it comes very, very close to parental love, because with our children, and it's really sad that some children do things that are really, you go, how can somebody continue to love them? But if that's your child, you are devastated because they did something that was terrible. However, they're still your child and you love them. You know, so this divine love, probably the closest we can understand is that parental love. We use the word agape, that's the Greek word, and what does it kind of encompass? So a strong, positive emotion of regard and affection, trust, appreciation, respect. And when I came up with that word trust, I realized that's the bottom line for me. That idea of love, that unconditional love, is to be able to trust somebody, something, some power, unconditionally. So I invite you to kind of explore within yourself, what of those kinds of words really speak to you? What does this mean that I can love this divine essence unconditionally? This essence that loves me, what does it take for me to do that? What does it mean to trust? Now, there's people that I do love in my life that I don't trust. And while the love, because they're family members in many ways, is unconditional, it's not something that I'm going to put any faith in. It's not something that I'm going to depend on in any way. So when we look at this divine love, for me, it is, here is something I can put my absolute faith and trust in. And how did I get there? How did I get there? You can look at your own self and say, okay, what does this mean to me as an individual? Do I trust that which I use the word God? And we use here, we use many words, divine mind, higher self, the universe. Do I trust it? And if I do, why? And if I don't, why? What kind of experience have you had over your lifetime that says, yes, I trust what is going on here? So one of the things that when you're in love with somebody, you talk to them a lot, right? Well, it's a good thing God loves me unconditionally because I'm always chattering away. I'm always chattering. Okay, God, here's what's going on, you know. Okay, God, I need help. And I don't know if I actually do this with conversations with other people. I know I do. I do it with my cats. Okay, cat, you know, I start with okay. So, okay, okay, God. Okay, that is entering into this connection that I know that power is aware and is listening. You know, what's going on? Here's what's bothering me here at the moment. And I don't have a clue how to handle it. I'm open. I you know, come through me, speak through me, do this through me. Debbie, who has spoken up here just a couple of weeks ago, but other times, and who, as we speak, she and Renee are having a different experience of God, with God, up with Edwin Gaines, up at the retreat center up in the mountains. But she talks about, you know, she's a counselor, and she talks about praying when she knows she's got clients coming in. Okay, not for something specific, not that she will just have exactly the right fix, right? But that whatever comes up, that those words that are necessary, she will have those words, and she shared those stories many times. You know, here it is. These people are having, they're in pain. Something is going on, and I, Debbie, personality, person, don't know what to do. And she says those words will come through. Those words will come through, the right thing. And part of her is kind of sitting back in awe, going, oh, thank you. Olga shares every once in a while with class, getting up in class, and things will come up that she didn't prepare for. She didn't have any way of preparing for it. But because she asks and allows that divine energy to come through her, and she just said this morning, you know, I will say things that will, and I'm standing back and going, ooh, where did that come from? Probably most of you have had that kind of an experience. You know, I allow that divine energy to flow in and through me, so that which my personality could not have ever picked up on came through me. Maybe it's something that you were doing. Amy, I don't know if this works, Barry, when you're in performance, but I would almost bet that it does. You know, there's a time in a performance that part of you says, okay, I need something other than just what's in my head to come out through this process. So when you're in that place of absolute trust of God and knowing that it's coming on, you can allow that energy to come through you. And here's another quote I just discovered. Let me tell you, you can learn a lot from reading murder mysteries. I'm reading right now, so it's a quote from Meister Eckhart, because the mystery has a lot to do with the end of his life. So he lived in the 1300s. He said, my Lord told me a joke. Seeing him laugh has done more for me than any scripture I will ever read. Has God ever told you a joke? I bet you, if you think about it, yeah. Do you have a relationship that this divine energy laughs with you, that laughs through you? And look at the marvelous jokes that we have, the creative jokes. Look at some of the animals that are around. Somebody, something taking this power with a sense of humor. You know, meet a kangaroo, meet a platypus, meet monkeys, meet... And somebody with an imagination far beyond ours, you know, made these gorgeous birds and the colors and the flowers. So people send these pictures over email that will show flowers that have angels and monkey faces and, you know, and it just goes on and on and on. You know, you think about that creative energy that has this lightness, that has a sense of humor, and it's there for us. It's there for us to see that. That gift, whatever we have that has made us a little lower than the angels and a little higher than the animals around, that gave us a perception to be able to see and to experience things. Think about that love that created that. And when I'm in a place of complete trust, how do I behave in the world when I'm in a place of trust? What happens when something that is scary comes up, whatever that might be? It may be a physical situation. If I can be in a place of trust, I don't know about you, but if I get really scared, you know, things don't work really, really well with me physically. So if I can be in a place of trust and say, okay, God, you got to do this. You got to do this. That energy moves and flows through me. What about when somebody when somebody does something that has the potential of you being angry with, how do you respond? Do you think if you're in a place of complete trust and knowing that you would not take it personally? You would say, okay, this is where this person is, and I don't agree with them. It doesn't mean that I'm having to agree. It doesn't even mean that in some way, if there is a verbal abuse, that I don't respond maybe in a protective way, or maybe not, to be able to say, you know, I understand that's how you feel. Mine or not, you know, it's easy to say, and I do it anyway, as you know, well, I understand where you're coming from. Well, chances are I do not understand where you're coming from, but I understand that you feel that way. I understand you feel that way. You know, how would that stop a lot of the things that are going on here constantly? And I know I've mentioned up here several times, but I hear it on such a regular basis where people will say they've let go of friends, they don't speak to family members. Well, let me tell you, when I grew up, there were three things you didn't talk about. They were money, religion, and politics. You know, at this point in time now, those of us who are in and these out, we love talking about religion. And we're in a place that we accept and maybe even expect people's differences. But how many of us have people who are in a very different place and are totally willing not to talk about our beliefs? Because we know they're in a different place, and that's where they are. And we love them, and we appreciate them. Can we bring that into our political process? Can we bring that into that? To say, we know there's this huge divide, and sometimes it's in family members, sometimes it's in church families, sometimes it's in best friends. Can we say, let's not go there when we're together? We know there is a difference. We know we have differences. And can I do that from a place of complete confidence and lack of fear within myself? Not necessarily confidence that I'm completely right. That's ego. That's personality. The confidence that there is love in this world. And then that person who is disagreeing with me has just as much God in them as I have in me. Can we bring ourselves to that place? So I want you to think about that, because I see all this energy that's floating around, and I hear a lot of people say, I'm not going there, I don't go on Facebook anymore, I'm not doing this. But pay attention to where you are and where those feelings are. And what is the fear? What is the fear? So part of it is, I'm not supposed to be shutting off here. I'm paying attention to the fear. I'm paying attention to the fear. And can I ask myself, what is that fear? Can I begin to explore that fear and
part of that is going to be, maybe I'm not in this place of complete trust. And so that's part of what I want to do. I want to come together. I want to know that wherever I am, God is. Wherever I am, God is. Can we be in that? Can we move towards that? Can that be a goal that we have? To be in that place of love and acceptance. And here's another quote that from Meister Eckhart. So here's all our opportunities out here to do or to not do. And he says, do exactly what you would do if you felt most secure. Do exactly what you would do if you felt most secure. Think about that. Think about what does that mean, coming from a place of love. So somebody sent out an email, it was Facebook thing the other day, and was having some experiences, having some experiences with spirits, and was asking for, comments on that process. And this is a person who's coming from a place of love, and is a person who has had experiences with that spiritual phenomena in the past, positive, and that was not where she was, and so she let it go, but now seems to be showing up. And so it was interesting looking at the level of responses. And there were people who were supportive and go, okay, if that's where you are right now, there must be something here, for you to be looking at moving and doing. And there was a couple on there that were very fearful. They weren't attacking this person, but they were very fearful. They were coming from a place of fear. And most of these people are also connected to A Course in Miracles. And what does the Course in Miracles give as advice in any situation? What would love do? So I just kind of put that in. What would love do? So you ask yourself, what would love do? So when I'm secure, means am I secure? Not in my ego that says, I got this handled, I know how to do this, I've been trained. Oh my goodness, let me look out there. But that part of you that says, love, God love. Am I secure in that love? Am I secure in my intention to do what love would do in this situation? And each one of us can only ask ourselves at that place. One of the things about having this trust is, how have you seen results in your life about when you put yourself in the hands of the divine? Well, over many, many years, I have said, okay, here's what I'm looking for. Help me out. Have I always gotten what I asked for? No. But you know what? There have been a few things that I have spent years praying for. Oh God, please. Oh God, I want this. I didn't get it. And you know what? A few years down the line, I'm going, Thank you, God. And so what does that do to my trust? To say, okay, there are things that I ask for and don't come. Maybe this divine mind, maybe this all-loving, all-knowing essence that is the truth of my being knows something I don't know. So can I be in that place of saying, this is something that I want. However, I'm willing to be in that place of not having it, of trusting that divine mind knows something that I don't know. But now that has to do with big things. What about the everyday little things? People pay attention to the smallest things that happen in your life, and you begin to realize that this divine mind isn't just out there for the emergencies and the big things. That this divine energy is there for you when you can't find something, when you need something very specific or whatever out here. Pay attention to what is going on. And somebody told me a
story the other day, and I've heard this several times. So this is was a particular story for this person's situation, but Edwin Gaines has told this story. Other people have told this story. Was going through a very difficult divorce kind of situation, and had a really deep spiritual experience that said, "Oh, I don't have to go to that negative place. I can be something different." And a few hours later, she's driving someplace, and she sees a sign that says, "Drama-free divorce." A billboard. You know, so sometimes the signs are actual signs. You know, pay attention. Sometimes, you know, God told me a joke. I put a billboard up here for you. That's kind of like a joke for me. In case you missed it, I have this out there. Pay attention to science. You know, I've been putting these quotes in there from quantum physicists and everything. You know, science is an amazing door into the process of finding out what this creative essence is. And many, many scientists are deep, deep believers in many ways that said, you know, it can't possibly just be an accident. You know, whatever that beginning process was, even if you look at it and you say, and it was the Big Bang, whatever instituted that Big Bang did it in a way that everything in the universe works together and it supports life. It supports life. And life is probably the rarest form of material in the universe. In Matthew, Jesus says, "Seek first the kingdom of God and all else will be added." So when we understand, what is that kingdom? The kingdom is in here. The kingdom is out here. The kingdom is here and now present. So that kingdom that Jesus talked about is this wonderful, amazing process that this divine has created for us, and we seek that process. It doesn't say, okay, then you'll be poor, but that's okay. You'll love God, and God will love you, and you'll be quite happy being poor. He says, no, and all else will be added to you. All else, whatever that is that will create that full and valuable life for us. Is that an incentive to say, oh, yes, yes. Let me look at this love affair that I've been having, or maybe not having. You know, can I begin to make that connection? And in closing, you know, again, Meister Eckhart, I could have titled this Meister Eckhart Says. He's the one, we've heard this many times, but Meister Eckhart is one says, if the only prayer you ever say is thank you, that is enough. That is enough. What a place to start. I don't have to do anything else. I can just be aware. I can just say thank you. And again, reminded, we love because divine love, creative love, first loved us and provided a universe that it has the potential to fulfill our every want, need, and desire. Thank you. No.
They're going to sing it. They're going to sing another song. It's a new song, but it's real repetitive. Come on, stand up. Stand up, you can do this. It's my God is, okay, this is it. My good is my God, my God is my good. All the good there is belongs to me. My good is my God is my good. All the good I seek belongs to me. And then I'll sing one time through, and then it'll be my good is my joy, and then my good is my love, and then my good is my God. So I'll sing it through, you'll get, it's fine. Trust me. My God is my good. All the good there is belongs to me. My good is my God. My God is my good. All the good I seek belongs to me. That's my truth with a capital T. I have all I ever need. I have all I am.
good. All the good there is belongs to me. My good is my God. My God is my good. All the good I seek belongs to me. That's my truth with a capital T.
Reverend Carol this morning, it really fit. And my prayer this morning is that as you hear the song, if there's a part in here that just doesn't speak to you, place it aside and allow the rest of the song to come. And hopefully there is some positive that it will bring to you. And I think the whole thing resolves in the end to a hope that we all need when we experience those dark times. Mountain of